This one right here is actually called Cartoons and Skeletons. There's something about closet hangers that watches way too much cartoons that bothers me. Kind of like a childhood trauma long forgotten but still holding on innocence acting as night terrors. There must have been something wrong with me. To envision hangers transform themselves into skeleton hands holding on to the Saturday morning ankles of children who are but victims in a marriage, hanging up secrets in closets, destroyed by infidelity, all before a commercial break. Unbeknownst to the betrayal of the flesh, the degree silence has broken the bond of three siblings. See, it was a family of five. A father who was much more than a rolling stone. A boulder who believed that family trees grows downhill, so he didn't know how to stop painting new children for the homes he destroyed. A mother who learned that patience is much more than a virtue, is a survival trait of one that left a third world lifestyle for a lifestyle of the third world kind, the irony. Who can cook up Thanksgiving miracles when all she had was ketchup and white rice, but she couldn't make love from scratch. Who never knew the secrets to growing a loving family in the ghetto. See, she was the flower that bloomed in poverty. A son who was a transcript from a previous relationship, whose rap sheet was at least twice his age, asthmatic ways found fresh air hidden within rolled up plans of, let me pretend not to hear this, lit with the light of, this isn't my business, inhaling escape artist syndromes. Two kids, no older than a box of crayons. Myself, just learning how to color within the lines despite having only one able eye to see through, meaning happiness will be gained at a 50-50 chance depending on what side of my face the sun decides to laugh at. The other, just learning how to crawl despite having a curved spine as if God had arthritis when he molded this child, still young enough to not put tears to tragedy, she'll probably be safe. My baby sister. This is the perfect family from the outside looking in. But we all know that perfection is just glorified opinion. How do you tell a child that's young enough to not comprehend, but old enough to still be affected, it is not their fault for the splitting of a family? See, I learned that being the middle child means you'll be caught in the eye of every family storm. See, I was a child that practiced tiptoeing around temper tantrums because floor tiles were disguised as a graveyard of eggshells, and mom trots with yoking hands ready to scramble up the face of one that reminds her of his father isn't my fault. When breathing is now a sin, so I find myself praying on top of rice in corners that felt like God was just way too big to fit in and listen. This is the time where I felt like he was truly skipping me, as though his hands were too big to slide the ignore button. And he didn't have a voicemail set up, so you know my take on faith. I'm living proof that you can read Bible verses hundreds of times by physical force of a spiritual mountain-like woman and still not remember a single line. And speaking of kneeling on rice, I learned that it took approximately 26 minutes for me to bleed, 42 for it to seep in and sting, 113 to crack from numbness, and yes, it's a potential sleeping position. A childhood made of sleepless nights and chills, a childhood made of sleepless nights and chills. A sandbox made of fraud and pills. A financial Milky Way for emotionally controlled laughters, faking mental illnesses for a monthly pat on the back. But an uncle named Tom, or was it Sam? It didn't matter because everyone who smiled at me was starting to look like Morpheus. There was never a red or a blue choice. Simply take it with the drink or mix it with the food. Playing hide and seek with imaginary friends to avoid cable wires and belt buckles. But beatings or heat-seeking missiles, leaving radiation, bruises, and welts. See, I was a master at hiding scars. I know what this sounds like. But pain, it comes to me like nursery rhymes. So if you ever hear me chanting, ring around the rosies, it's simply me learning from pockets that a child cannot carry posies. Golden rings cannot properly inscribe memories of tormented glories, and tears do fall down from time to time, but everything I said before and hereafter is a true story. See, I learned two very important rules. Rule number one,
Mom is always right. Rule number two, if mom is wrong, please see rule number one. See, I was always told that discipline raises a respectful individual in today's society. But would you not then say that unnecessary discipline bursts a defiant face to then face trials and tribulations and only painful guidelines as some sort of waypoint to a destination of independence? But old scars bleed when you find yourself too far from home. Homesickness. Once again, the irony.
Whoa.
To use the mic because I really don't like to hear my voice being amplified. I hate the sound of my voice. Watch, half of y'all gonna see the recordings of y'all own performance. Like, that's how I sound like. But I tend to really write about, you know, everyday situations, domestic violence, police brutality, so forth and so forth, especially within the urban community, because all in all, I'm an urban writer. And I'll give you one on domestic violence. This is called collateral damage. Collateral damage. Damage to things that are incidental to the intended target. Example, a father just recently fired 2 days prior to retirement after spending 25 years of neglecting his family just picked up his old habit of playing basketball, shooting back whiskeys. Swish, swish until wife calls foul play for laying up hands to her rim, the child. Listening in to comic book pals, just learned that stepdaddy is no Superman in your DC home, Marvel, and villainous acts. Collateral damage. Let us pretend that the child is a boy. He then grows up believing that women are only knuckles weak and good bedroom freaks, but was smart enough to never take daddy's basketball too far to hanging up jerseys and baskets, I mean caskets, of white sheets. See, there's a chain reaction to these things. And this isn't a story about any one of you. This isn't a story about me. But somewhere in this world, there is a he that witnessed the she dangling remnants of a broken soul by the seams of her sleeves, and no magic box allows magicians to cut deeper than his knees, blows to the guts, butterflies whispers for the L-O-V-E. It's for the L-O-V-E. Butterflies whispers for the L-O-V-E, and that's tragedy. When we see victims daily and we only say, that's sad to see. We only extend condolences. We don't want to get burned in a third degree. See, first is he, second is she with bruises, you see. Third is we if our fingers weren't too deep in a pool of bloodstream. Domestic is the scene, but it's a different kind of cut right after the action. See, as a child, I could tell you how my mother's jaw was painted outside of her line. I've witnessed crumbling crayons break playgrounds with bawling eyes. I could tell you how a floor towel had essence of my mother's back still having blood between its cracks, so every time I stepped on them, it felt like it was me beating her into Labor Day. Hunches and I was elementary school weak to defend her. Now, every time I see him, he's far too frail to even contemplate avenging her. Now, that's a cake I could never eat. A sweet tooth with the fading blood stain that's dripping at my feet. See, I walk with my family tree and my mother's veins in its leaves. See, my face is just like hers, but he wouldn't dare swing at me. Why do us men believe that our hands are quicker than God's eyes? See, if pain could materialize from victims' eyes beyond the steps it would take to realize that we have demoralized the very fabric of what a man represents by laying hands to her sense, and what sense is there in asking for forgiveness if we acted without our two cents? See, this is a story all too common all around the globe, but opening up with my previous example, what if the child listening in to abuse was a girl? How would the story unfold? I'm gonna end it on a happier note. It's a dancing piece, kinda. I don't know if y'all have, like, going to the club lately, but dancing in today's society now is basically dry humping. That's basically what it is. I mean, I'm 25, but I know how to dance. So it's like, I remember the days where dancing was actually dancing and not foreplay. And this is a piece that I've written for the occasion. It's called Dancing.
I have entered a bathhouse of rhythmic tunes that knows no bounds between saint or sinner. When shoes and heels play shackle, we kick to freedom to escape the humanity and enter the primal rage of dancing. Because although we learned that guilty feet ain't got no rhythm, dance like no one's looking. So the next time a DJ speaks to you in the only lingo they know how, when their voice lullabies the air enough to bounce off walls and create a vibrato in your body, remember to close your eyes and dance like no one's looking. See, the true meaning of dancing is hidden behind a facade that is simply sex with a layer of protection. But before I was ever able to properly break down syllables, my parents taught me how to be light on my feet. My dad used to say, you gotta dance at your hips if you wanna get the checks. My mom used to say, you gotta stomp your feet if you wanna be like me. But since I'm a bachata, made for myself some merengue love, I simply created my own little beat. See, to me, dancing is the physical embodiment of the bottle we all hold dear, enticing may be, but it's supposed to be sex free. So the next time you enter a bathhouse of rhythmic tunes that knows no bounds between saint and sinner, so if you close your eyes, dance like I was looking.
I love you, man.